Egyptian President Gamal Abdel Nasser nationalizes the Suez Canal July 26, 1956, and provokes a tsunami of reactions from the rest of the world. The Arab world is elated about this defiant act. The Western world is less thrilled, but there's one reaction Nasser definitely is not counting on. Three nations secretly get together and decide to invade Egypt. Welcome to a Time Ghost chronological documentary series on the Suez Crisis. I'm Indy Neidell. We saw last time how Nasser took control of Egypt and how Britain withdrew militarily from the Canal Zone in 1956. We saw political, military, and financial intrigues between Britain, the US, the Soviet Union, France, Egypt, and Israel, and Nasser's desire to become the regional power, to hopefully lead the Arab world against Western imperialism. The Western world does not know what Nasser will do next. Many suffer from Munich syndrome, comparing Nasser's audacity with Hitler's expansionism of the 1930s. British Prime Minister Anthony Eden remarks, "It's exactly like when we tried to discuss things in the 1930s, and it is foolish to imagine that containing Nasser peacefully is possible." It is enough for Eden to be sure about one thing: Nasser must go. Eden sees the nationalization as an existential threat to the British Empire. Writing to the British ambassador in Washington, "If we sit back while Nasser consolidates his position and gradually acquires control of the oil-bearing countries, he can and is, according to our information, resolved to wreck us. If Middle Eastern oil is denied to us for a year or two, our gold reserves will disappear. If our gold reserves disappear, the sterling area disintegrates. If the sterling area disintegrates and we have no reserves, we shall not be able to maintain a force in Germany or indeed anywhere else. I doubt whether we shall be able to pay for the bare minimum necessary for our defense, and a country that cannot provide for its defense is finished." France, Britain, and the US meet already July 31st to discuss a collective course of action. Britain and France are in favor of military intervention. America, not so much. So the three release a joint statement declaring that Egypt is violating the 1888 Constantinople Convention, which says that the Suez Canal shall be a freely accessible international waterway. The three powers urge the international community to come together at a conference to be held in London. They meet from the 16th to the 23rd of August. This is the eight signatories of the 1888 pact that still exist, and 16 other major users of the Suez Canal. They propose that the canal be operated by the international community. Nasser just says no. Australian Prime Minister Robert Menzies. Now, I know some of you are gonna write in and say that that name is pronounced Mingus. Menzies actually spent the first half of his life lobbying for it to be pronounced Mingus, but everybody calls him Menzies because that's how it looks like it's spelled. But that Z is actually not a Z traditionally. It's an old Scottish letter, Yog. So in old Scottish pronunciation, it is Mingus. But Menzies or Mingus, he says, "Reason, logic, enlightened self-interest, all these considerations have no effect on Nasser. In fact, we don't speak the same language." The United States, still not willing to resort to military measures, proposes that a set of rules should be drafted by the canal's major users. A second conference is held in September, but not much is accomplished there either. Still, President Eisenhower remains hopeful for a diplomatic solution. But while America continues to walk that route, Britain and France are not willing to wait and start paving a military one. Eden is confident that America will join in collective military action, or at least support it when it becomes clear that Nasser cannot be reasoned with. But French Minister of Foreign Affairs Christian Pinault tells Eden and British Foreign Secretary Selwyn Lloyd that they should act bilaterally rather than do nothing trilaterally. Legal grounds, though, on which to base an invasion or the capture of the Suez Canal are close to non-existent. Law officers of the British Crown state, "We are on an extremely bad wicket legally as regards using force in connection with the Suez Canal. Whatever illegalities the Egyptians may have committed, these do not in any way justify forcible action on our part. Such a justification could only arise, if at all, from some further and much more drastic step on the part of the Egyptian government amounting to a closure of the canal, or at any rate, a definite refusal or impeding passage through it." However, the British cabinet is prepared to go to war over this, and if necessary, go at it alone. But that doesn't seem necessary, as France is perhaps even more keen to step in. The canal nationalization gives France a pretext for getting rid of a national enemy. See, despite promises to cease sending aid to Algerian independence fighters, who are causing great turmoil in France and Algeria, Nasser continues to provide it. French Premier Guy Mollet and Pinault see this as their top priority, with Pinault even saying that France considers it more important to defeat Colonel Nasser's enterprise than to win 10 battles in Algeria. France fears for the future of the whole region. Meeting with American Secretary of State John Foster Dulles, Pinault says that, according to the most reliable intelligence sources, we have only a few weeks in which to save North Africa. Of course, the loss of North Africa would then be followed by that of Black Africa, and the entire territory would rapidly escape European control and influence. So, plans for an invasion of Egypt and the removal of the Nasser government are being drafted. The British Army presents a first draft for an invasion already August 2nd. A second plan called Musketeer is soon presented by the three task force commanders. Initially, they call for an amphibious assault on Port Said or Alexandria, but a third plan, Operation Musketeer Revise, is drawn up by Allied Commander-in-Chief General Charles Keightley. Alexandria is scrapped as an objective as it might cause too many civilian casualties. Instead, 3 days of aerial activity to neutralize the Egyptian Air Force. Then 7 to 11 days will be spent attacking economically significant targets to cripple Egypt's economy. Then the Allies would occupy the canal zone virtually unopposed. The only thing that the Allies need now is a pretext to attack. Again, the canal occupation does not offer a legal basis for an invasion, nor does it satisfy international public opinion for one. Bombing Egypt to smithereens might seem a little excessive as long as Nasser has not abused the ownership of the Suez Canal. And anyhow, the British do not want to be seen as aggressors on the international stage. They still want to persuade the Americans to join. So they carry out several plots to try and create a pretext for invasion, like the pileup. Having the Suez Company canal pilots leave their posts and then sending a big influx of shipping into the canal all at once to cause the flow of traffic to come to a halt. But Egyptian pilots managed to get all the traffic through without a problem, so Egypt is not giving the Allies a whole lot to work with. But, what if Britain and France don't invade? What if they simply intervene in a war that someone else is fighting? Now, as I said last time, Israel is increasingly worried about Egypt as a regional power. Egypt continues to sponsor Arab Fedayeen militias that raid Israel, mainly from the Gaza Strip. Egypt blockades Israeli shipping in the Straits of Tiran and the Suez Canal and keeps building up its military capacity. But France has been aiding Israel with arms shipments since before the nationalization. And France and Israel have been working on collective plans to invade Egypt since July. It would be great for France and Britain, though, if Israel would go to war with Egypt first. Although Britain is also actually worried about Israel. The British have been committed to curbing Israel's military presence since the Israeli-Arab War in 1948. And Britain is allied with Israel's neighbor Jordan, and is even obliged to come to Jordan's aid in case of an Israeli attack. But most importantly, British influence in the Middle East is tied to the Arab states through the Baghdad Pact and the oil trade. Israel equally mistrusts Britain, though. Israeli Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion writes in his diary October 17th, "The British plot, I imagine, is to get us involved with Nasser and bring about the occupation of Jordan by Iraq." Clashes between Jordan and Israel in early October even bring Britain and Israel to the brink of war. But as has often been the case throughout history, having a common enemy is a great motivator for overcoming one's differences. What follows is a secret scheme, as secret a scheme as secret schemes can get, to make war with Egypt. Mollet, Eden, and Ben-Gurion meet in Paris to discuss their plans. The British and French idea is for Israel to go to war with Egypt in the Sinai Desert. The French and British would then call the belligerents to halt and withdraw from the immediate vicinity of the canal. If one or both refused, Anglo-French forces would intervene to ensure the free passage of the canal. still mistrusting the British and not wanting to become a scapegoat or military target while the British and French pose as peacemakers, Ben-Gurion declines. But the French, keen to move fast and move aggressively, arrange a new meeting for all the mistrust and all the demands to be worked out. On October 22, 1956, representatives of the three countries begin talks in the French town of Sèvres. These talks could fill several books. And Ben-Gurion lays out in detail his grand design for the whole Middle East, and you should look up the Protocol of Sèvres for yourself. But relevant to this story, on the 24th, Ben-Gurion writes in his diary, "I think we have to undertake this operation. This is a unique opportunity that two not-so-small powers will try to topple Nasser, and we shall not remain alone against him while he becomes stronger and conquers all Arab countries." He defines Israel's immediate war aims with Egypt as annexation of the entire area east of the El Arish Sharm al-Sheikh axis in order to permanently secure freedom of navigation in the Straits of Tehran, and to stop the danger posed by the Egyptian army bases in Sinai and the Egyptian-supported attacks from the Gaza Strip. Britain and France must support, or at least not show opposition to these goals. And this is the plan to gain that victory. Now, the main British concern is that the Israeli thrust be deep enough to pose a real threat to the Suez Canal's safety. So Israel will launch a large-scale attack on the evening of the 29th of October with the aim of reaching the canal zone the following day. The Israeli invasion of Sinai is named Operation Kadesh. The IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces leader, Moshe Dayan, plans for mobile battles of encirclement combined with air power. Paratroops will seize distant points first, with the furthest being Mitla Pass, close to Suez, which will be taken by the 202nd Paratroop Brigade, commanded by Colonel Ariel Sharon. This move is supposed to split the entire Sinai Desert in two, disrupting Egyptian supply and reinforcement lines. The next part of the plan is for the British and French to appeal to the belligerents to stop their fighting. After 12 hours have passed, Israel and Egypt will be urged to withdraw their forces to more than 10 miles from the canal. Egypt is then asked to allow the temporary occupation of key positions on the canal. The plan expects Egypt to not accept the demands, giving Anglo-French forces the right to intervene to enforce compliance. And if Egypt refuses as planned, then Israel isn't forced to comply either, basically allowing the three states to wage war against Egypt together. 48 hours after D-Day, Operation Musketeer Revise will kick off, deploying 45,000 British soldiers, 34,000 Frenchmen, close to 250 warships, including 7 aircraft carriers, and thousands of vehicles. Musketeer Revise will start with Allied airstrikes on Egyptian airfields. Port Said is then to be shelled by the Allied naval force, as well as from the skies. As a part of the big operation, Operation Telescope then plans to drop the British 3rd Battalion Parachute Regiment west from Port Said to capture the El Gamil airfield. French paratroops are to be dropped simultaneously to take Port Fouad. They will pave the way for a seaborne landing on Port Said, allowing reinforcements and heavy equipment to enter the fight. An armored push with AMX-13 and Centurion 4 tanks will then be made south down the canal toward Ismailia. From there, the offensive shifts southwest to take Cairo, the capital, remove Nasser from power, and install a new government. At the same time, another force will continue to Suez itself. And all of this has to be kept an absolute dead secret. Eden will later deny the agreement exists. But in actuality, now, he is furious when he hears that the representatives physically sign the secret protocol and distribute copies. And he wants all those copies found and destroyed, for the signed protocol is a smoking gun. If the world finds out that the British are plotting against their Arab allies to create a pretext for military invasion and conquest and to manipulate the UN and international opinion, Eden and Britain will be in deep, deep trouble, as will France and Israel. But with the signing of the Protocol of Sèvres, the die is cast. When Israel attacks on October 29th and when the Allied nations present their ultimatum to Egypt to back down, it is all according to plan. But will Egypt back down? Or with all of their Soviet military equipment and Nasser's determination, will they refuse and kickstart an invasion at Egypt by not one, not two, but three nations? If you would like to see another video on far-reaching collusion, you can check out our video on the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact right here. The Time Ghost Army member of the week is Michael Dow or Dove. Okay, well, be like Michael anyway, and the Time Ghost Army, and support us at patreon.com or timeghost.tv. The war effort needs you. Subscribe, ring that bell. See you next time.